Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. All my video lectures are mainly for educative purpose. Today we are going to discuss on one very interesting topic seen very commonly in children. We call Kawasaki disease. This disease is quite common in children. If you have got in back of your mind regarding a clinical picture, and when you see in a children certain findings, you will suspect these disorders. And if you diagnose early, treat them early, you can prevent a very dangerous complication which are lethal for the children. Hence, identification of a Kawasaki disease in an early stage is very, very useful, because in children very frequently you will come across viral fever, other types of fever like scarlet fevers, etc., which are a very close differential diagnosis of Kawasaki. So you must be able to clinically suspect and identify this disorder. So it is also called as a Kawasaki disease or Kawasaki syndrome, also known as a mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome. Meaning is very simple, there is a mucocutaneous finding plus there is a lymphadenopathy. And this is a very important clue for suspecting a Kawasaki disease. So called as a Kawasaki syndrome or Kawasaki disease. As routine, we'll be discussing under these headings. Now here, before we go into that topic, I'm showing you one case presentation. That is, a child came with a chief complaint of fever for 16 days. See, this is very important. Fever is persistent and it is for a longer period. And along with that fever, you can see that person is having rash, is having mucocutaneous finding. This is cutaneous and oral cavity finding will be muco finding. These are all cutaneous finding. Child is having fever and you can see this skin finding, that is cutaneous finding. You can see this is a mucus, that is conjunctiva is also being involved. So this is an important clue. And you will get oral cavity findings, that is tongue. These are skin findings. You can see this exfoliation of a skin along with persistent fever in a children, conjunctiva involvement, skin involvement, mucous membrane involvement, oral cavity, tongue, inner side of the oral cavity, pharynx, and skin findings do suspect. This child was having WBC 20,000, hemoglobin was 10, platelet count was very high. This is another clue. Then electrolyte was normal, AST was little elevated, ESR was high, CRP was high. So these are called inflammatory markers. So if these are elevated, this is another clue. ECG initially was normal, but when echo was done, it showed a large aneurysm of a right coronary artery and left circumflex artery. This is the diagnostic clue for Kawasaki. And a repeat ECG which was done showed anterior infarct. You can see in a child, and this is because of aneurysm. And to reconfirm that, CT angio was done. There was a large aneurysm in RCA and a left circumflex, because this produces arthritis, and that is involving coronary artery, and that will end up with aneurysm. So certain clue: leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, ESR, CRP, that is inflammatory markers elevation, and aneurysm. Clue for diagnosis of Kawasaki. So now we are going with the Kawasaki disease. Kawasaki disease is an acute systemic vasculitis commonly seen in children. It is idiopathic, involving medium-sized artery. So it is an involvement of a medium-sized artery, and that we call as a vasculitis, that is inflammation of blood vessels. Also, there is an involvement of the mucous membrane as well as skin and lymph node. So it was also called as a mucocutaneous lymph node syndrome. By and large, it is a self-limiting, very frequently associated with fever, and there is an inflammation signs. By and large, 12 days is an average duration, and if not treated early, then you can have a dangerous complication like coronary artery aneurysm, which can end up with MI, can have cardiac arrhythmias, and even person can develop a peripheral arterial occlusion, and a person can end up with a severe congestive heart failure, and mortality rate will be very, very high. So this slide itself tells you the entire clinical picture. If you look at the epidemiology, if you see this, most common, almost we say that 75% of the time, it is less than 5 years of age children, and only in 25% of the people, it is more than 5 years. Again, ratio, if you consider male to female, it is male is little more preponderance as compared to female. It is 1.3:1 ratio. And it is very frequently following an infection like staphylococci or streptococci, which will give rise to an immune response. There will be activation of a T cells, neutrophils, monocytes, which will initiate the inflammation in an artery, particularly involving a medium-sized artery, and that is we call vasculitis. So this is a normal artery inflammation and can end up with what we call as aneurysm. Because of inflammation, you will have a neutrophils, mononuclear cells, lymphocytes, plasma cells, all these different types of immune mediated cells will be infiltrated into the vascular wall, producing vasculitis, and then later on the destruction of the vascular wall will end up with aneurysm. What is the clinical picture? We say fever plus mucocutaneous inflammation. This is the earliest finding. So fever is the most important clue, most consistent finding. The person will have a fever which is minimally responsive to the antipyretics and usually remains very close to 38.5 or even little more than this. And whenever the fever persists for a little longer period, in spite of oral antipyretics, do consider Kawasaki disease. And further suspicion by mucocutaneous inflammation, that is conjunctiva, it is a bilateral conjunctivitis, non-exudative, this is very important. You will have a only corner being inflamed in 90% of the patient and within days of fever of onset. So as soon as the fever starts, very frequently within few days you will see conjunctivitis. Second common finding is a rash, which is usually polymorphous variety, begins during first few days, and then you can have a fourth finding, what we call as a lymphadenopathy, mucocutaneous lymphadenopathy syndrome, that is cervical lymphadenopathy, and some of the lymph nodes are even as big as 1.5 centimeter. This again goes in favor. You can see conjunctivitis, you can see different types of rash, and there is a lymphadenopathy. This is a clue. Along with that, you can have a strawberry tongue. Very frequently described, this is a strawberry tongue. Describe a strawberry tongue. It is a red lips, cracks. Extremities will show you peeling of the skin, starting from the under nails, periungual desquamation, palmar and plantar erythema, edema of hand and feet. These are additional changes which you can see. And these changes is another very, very important clue to suggest that this is heading or this is a diagnostic of Kawasaki disease. You might have arthritis, not in all, but large joints will be very frequently involved, but do not occur together. So arthritis may not be a common finding. Associated with nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain, cough, rhinorrhea, etc. These are all non-specific findings, but may be associated with mucocutaneous finding, lymph node findings, and extremities finding. Skin will show you different type of rash, maculopapular, morbilliform, targetoid forms, scarlatine forms, but vesicular forms are never seen in Kawasaki. That's why we have put this cross. It will include extremities and perianal region. You will have a rash. And particularly in extremities, you will have a erythema, edema, ischemia, and peeling of the skin. As far as ENT examination is concerned, we have told you that conjunctival injection, lips will be involved, will be red and cracked. Tongue will show you classical strawberry tongue. Oropharynx will be erythematous, lymphadenopathy. Very frequently cervical lymphadenopathy. The size is more than 1.5 centimeter. May be tender, may be unilateral. All these are important too. In clinical picture, there is a way of remembering, that is warm cream. Warm is fever for more than 5 days. Cream, C for conjunctivitis, R for rash, E for edema and extremity changes, A for adenopathy or lymphadenopathy, and M for mucocutaneous involvement. That's why it is called warm cream. And another way to remember, crash burn. C for conjunctivitis, R for rash, A for adenopathy, S for strawberry tongue, and H for hand and lower feet, lower limb involvement. That is rash, edema, and exfoliation of the skin. And burn for elevated body temperature. Whichever way you remember mucocutaneous lymphadenopathy and extremities involvement. Very easy way. So you can remember crash or cream. So crash or cream, whichever way you want to remember, and with fever. So conjunctivitis, rash, erythema, adenopathy, and mucous membrane involvement. Here, E was for edema and extremity change. Here, erythema and edema with extremity changes. Whichever way you want to remember. So, most commonly utilized is crash or cream, conjunctivitis, rash, adenopathy, strawberry tongue, hands and feet. Conjunctivitis is usually bilateral and non-purulent. Rash is usually polymorphic, more commonly seen on trunks and extremities. Occasionally you can see also in groin. Adenopathy is cervical, by and large unilateral, tender, and lymph nodes are more than 1.5 centimeters, good number of times. Strawberry tongue, and that is associated with involvement even of a pharynx and oral mucosa. And you will have a skin involvement of hand and feet, where you will see edema, erythema, and desquamation. If you look at the clinical manifestation of Kawasaki, during acute phase, you will have a fever, you will have a just beginning of arthritis, you might have a myocarditis, skin manifestation, conjunctivitis will start, lymphadenopathy will be starting, thrombocytosis, and it may last for 1 week or 1.5 week. And then in a case of subacute stage, fever will slowly now decline, arthritis will become peak and will decline. And now during this particular stage, there is always a chance of development of coronary artery vasculitis and ends up with aneurysm. And then you will have got cardiovascular complication like arrhythmias, failure, acute MI, etc. in children. In subacute phase, the rash will be now followed by desquamation, and in a convalescent stage, you will have a nail changes. In subacute phase, the lip changes and conjunctival changes will now slowly subside, lymphadenopathy will subside, thrombocytosis will subside by the end of subacute phase, and there will be no thrombocytosis in a convalescent phase. So in a convalescent phase, mainly you will have a complication because of vasculitis, and you might have a nail changes, and that will be after 6 to 7 weeks. This is a very important slide, tell you the entire course of Kawasaki disease. The child may be irritable, vital signs will be affected, he may be dehydrated, and there will be unilateral lymphadenopathy. But if there is a diffuse lymphadenopathy, it suggests viral illness. And very frequently the child is severely dehydrated, there is a gross change in the vital signs, and child may be irritable. So whenever a child comes with conjunctivitis, cervical lymphadenopathy, rash, strawberry tongue, hand changes, and burns and fever, do suspect Kawasaki. And good number of times this will be associated with CNS involvement, respiratory involvement, cardiovascular is as such involved because of the coronary artery vasculitis, GIT findings, there may be a involvement of even a bone, muscles, and even bladder may be involved. These are all the different structures which may be involved in Kawasaki. So you can have a coronary artery involvement, which is very, very common. And it is almost as common as 25% of the people who are untreated. And if they are timely treated, the complication of coronary artery aneurysm will reduce to less than 5%. And if untreated, it will be more than 25%. And secondary to that, person has got a very high chance of development of acute MI, congestive heart failure, arrhythmias. Person can end up with pericarditis, myocarditis, and complication because of pericarditis and myocarditis also. And there is a very, very high chance of coronary artery aneurysm rupture and death. As far as the diagnostic criteria is concerned, it is always said that any 4 of these 5 criteria with fever for more than 5 days. So if any child who has got a fever for more than 5 days, bilateral conjunctivitis, oral mucosa involvement, extremity changes, polymorphic rash, and lymphadenopathy, of this 5, any 4 criteria, if they are present, conjunctivitis, skin changes in palm and sole, rash, strawberry tongue, this is extremity changes, skin changes, and lymphadenopathy, goes directly in favor of a Kawasaki disease. And that's why they say that fever more than 5 days with either cream or crash with fever, and if they are less than 4, that is 2 or 3 criteria, then we use a term incomplete Kawasaki disease, which you can reconfirm by elevated CRP and elevated ESR, which are inflammatory biomarker, plus you will have other clue like normocytic anemia. If there is a normal platelet count initially and then you start getting thrombocytosis, there is an increased CRP and increased ESR and leukocytosis, and you have got even elevated liver enzymes like AST, ALT, those are elevated. So in a suspected person of a incomplete Kawasaki, always go for CRP and ESR. And if CRP is high, then you should have 3 or more laboratory findings to label that as Kawasaki and start treatment. And if it does not fit with that criteria, then you should have a regular follow-up. And person may be subjected to what we call as a laboratory re-evaluation and echo if required. I'll skip this particular slide. It is not so clear, but at your leisure time, you can go through that. Whenever you suspect a Kawasaki disease, first is a good history and clinical examination. We have told you cream or a crash with persistent 5 days history. And if the criteria, you get 4 out of 5, it is straightforward in favor of a Kawasaki disease. And in a person, what this is much better slide. That is, if there are only 2 or 3 criteria present, then we call incomplete Kawasaki. You go for CRP and ESR test, and then depending upon the marker of inflammatory markers, you can look for other findings like anemia, we call thrombocytosis, albumin being less, we call hypoproteinemia, elevated ALT, leukocytosis, and urine may show presence of WBC. These are all in favor of Kawasaki. So investigations like CBC, ESR, and CRP, LFT, renal parameters, urine analysis, and echo is a must. We already mentioned this particular thing, that elevated CRP, ESR, leukocytosis with elevation of platelet count and elevation of ALT is in favor. Baseline echo should be done and it should be regularly followed up every 7 days or 10 days to find out the complications. And you should observe for aneurysm after 10 days history. So there is always a clue in laboratory parameters, elevated CRP, elevated ESR, thrombocytosis, leukocytosis, pyuria, anemia, ALT elevation, even hyponatremia, hypoproteinemia goes in favor. Echocardiography is a must, and on echocardiography, if it shows coronary artery aneurysm or dilatation, pericardial effusion, valvular regurgitation or decreased LV function, it is a dangerous sign. In an uncomplicated Kawasaki, echo should be repeated every 1 or 2 weeks. And further, even you can repeat up to 6 weeks. We already mentioned that in some of the person, you might require a lifelong follow-up. Particularly if the child has developed aneurysm of RC or a left circumflex. And if there is a clinical evidence of myocardial involvement, you might require even a repeated ECG and CT NG also may be required. And cardiology follow-up should be done, and treatment will depend upon the severity of involvement of coronary artery. Kawasaki disease is a very close differential diagnosis of all other viral infection and bacterial infection, which can occur like measles, then exudative conjunctivitis, coplic spots, then drug reactions, then scarlet fever, rheumatic fever. You can have a differential diagnosis like toxic shock syndrome, staphylococcal infections, Steven Johnson, viral rash, etc. there are many, many conditions which can produce similar, but most important finding, if the fever is persistent for more than 5 days, and you have got a five of those criteria, you should suspect Kawasaki. As far as management is concerned, high dose of aspirin, IV fluids, and IV immunoglobulins. IV immunoglobulin and aspirin becomes the prime treatment to reduce the inflammation. And if there is a resistance, particularly if there is coronary artery involvement, prior to IV globulins, or children is less than 6 months old, and there is associated shock stage, there is a macrophage activation syndrome, and person is having a high risk, then you can add systemic glucocorticoids and you can repeat IVG, that is immunoglobulins. A single dose of IV immunoglobulins, 2 gram per kilogram, over 8 to 12 hours is given. High dose of aspirin, right from 80 to 100 milligram per kilogram per day in a divided dose. Glucocorticoid is usually given in a resistance variety, but you should also look at the contraindication of glucocorticoids in children. Now, this is a simple one good slide which is showing you that if on the day one you start with an anti-inflammatory, that is aspirin, and if there is a decreased risk, now aspirin given very early will decrease the risk of coronary artery aneurysm, as well as use of IV immunoglobulins will be very, very helpful if it is given in an early stage. But after day 10, even if the person is afebrile, moderate to high dose of aspirin should be given to reduce the chance of what we call as coronary artery vasculitis. Or after 72 hours, low dose of aspirin is continued for 4 to 6 weeks until aneurysm resolves. These are all the things what are being observed. And particularly when IV immunoglobulin is given, say even after 36 hours, if fever is without any other explanation, or there is a refractory Kawasaki, second dose of IV immunoglobulin should be given, or you should give other anti-inflammatory apart from aspirin. And as such, we have discussed these complications. The most common complications, which is a very, very dangerous one, is coronary artery aneurysm that can end up with acute MI, myocarditis, congestive heart failure and cardiac arrhythmias, pericarditis and pericardial effusion, and can end up with death. So these are all the complications. Take home points: early recognition and early treatment is absolutely must. No doubt it is difficult to diagnose, but if you got a high suspicion, then you will pick up them as early as possible. The best treatment is early starting of aspirin and IV immunoglobulins to prevent complications. So I end my lecture here. When you go for a private practice, this will be very helpful. This can be asked as a short note, can be asked as a full question. Kawasaki in your oral exams also it can be asked. So I feel this will be very, very helpful to you in your oral exam as well as theory. And when you start your private practice, particularly this is a disease which is seen in children. If you have got a high index of suspicion, you will be able to pick up. Always remember cream or crash. These are the 5 clues. Out of that, at least 4 should be present with persistent fever. You suspect Kawasaki and you can investigate properly, diagnose them early and treat them early. So at the end of this lecture, I thank you all for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable and I appreciate that You have spent some of the time with me. So if you like this lecture, please press button like, subscribe, and if you feel that this is also helpful to your friend, you can share with your friend.